morning. Happy Sabbath. Welcome. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you again, Father, for a most excellent Sabbath day. And yes, Lord, may we go onward into battle, Father, and realize that we're not here for ease and pleasure, but to spread this gospel message. Be with us this Sabbath day. May your spirit be here and your angels. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A lot of things going on, folks. Rats are starting to jump off the ship, too. It's amazing to see every time something happens, they all start pointing fingers. Interesting. Anyhow, we're going to continue on in Matthew 15. We're talking about the church versus Christ, basically. How the situation at Matthew's house and the revealing way that it had shown exactly where the church stood and what their attitude towards people is and was, and had mentioned that these principles of these situations have to be applied today, and how the fact that the Pharisees or the church had a great problem with who Jesus was associating with. Of course, the results thereof, we all know, are pretty amazing. And again, and I'll say this again, and I'm not going to, as we move on, I'm not going to say it again. The perception of the educated class of the Jews that would not submit to the Pharisees was quite sharp in the fact that they saw them as hypocrites. Matthew and his friends were not ignorant people. They were educated people. They were savvy people. And they had nothing to do with the Pharisees. Why? Because they, well, the church called them great sinners. What were they? You see? They saw them for what they were. They knew they were duping the people. Yeah, I might be sitting here collecting taxes for Rome, but I've got no disguise. You know what I am, but they don't know what you are. See the problem? But as soon as the real church came along, what did they do? They wanted a religion. They wanted God. They didn't want the Pharisees' religion. Now, how do we bring that up to today? Can you understand about the 144,000 a little better now, why they're not here? What have they perceived? What have they seen? What do they know? And when Jesus calls them, what are they going to do? What did Matthew do? You see? But we are supposed to be the Jesus to get the message out. When they hear the true and straight and honest, faithful witness, what are these people going to do? Now, forgetting the 144,000, the millions of people that are out there honestly searching for truth. When they hear truth, what are they going to do? They're going to leave what they're doing and follow it. Now let's continue on because I have some other things I want to get into here. Matthew 15:7. Ye hypocrites, well does Elias prophesy of you, saying, this people draw near unto me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their mind is far from me. Now the word is heart there, but it's not emotions. And when you put the word mind in there, which is the modern translation, it becomes a choice, you see. It becomes a choice. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. This was in full-blown contrast at Matthew's house. It was laid bare, laid wide open, seeing clearly that the doctrine of the Pharisees was not the commandments of God. And Jesus allowed this situation to happen for that very reason. Whenever he brought conflict into the situation, what was the purpose for it? And Jesus controlled that conflict, make no doubt about it. It was no random act on his part. Why did Jesus bring conflict into a situation? And who was always the conflict with? It was with the church, the established first century Seventh-day Adventist church. Jesus deliberately did things to cause conflict. Jesus knew there was going to be a ruckus at Matthew's house, so to speak, a row, as the British say. He knew that. He knew it was going to draw a crowd. But what was being shown there? Rita?
I don't know that it was so much that he was intentionally creating problems or a conflict. He needed to present the truth that was just in him to do that. And whenever you present the truth when there was false there, it's going to clash.
Mrs. White says he deliberately picked his places so that the Pharisees would be there and there would be a confrontation. Now, we see confrontation today in a different light. Why would he want to do that? Why in Matthew 23 would he stand in the temple and say the things he said? There had to be the truth. He didn't do it to cause an argument or fight. That wasn't the purpose, because many times he had a tear in his eye.
He had to expose the false.
He had to expose the false. And he didn't do it by preaching. How did he do it? Well, at Matthew's house, what was taking place? People could see these men have come to Christ. Why would they not go to the Pharisees? The Pharisees are condemning Jesus' act, not to him, to the crowd. What is going on in the people's minds? Wait a minute. Love thy brother? You see the conflict? The great controversy is a battle, folks. It's a war. Jesus brought the great controversy to the surface every chance he got, but he did it on his terms. He did it on his terms. Every time the Pharisees brought conflict to him, what did Jesus do? He shut it down immediately. What about when they asked him about paying tax? What did he do? Did he sit there and debate politics with them? Religious politics? Give me a coin. Whose picture's on it? He quickly shut it down. The marriage situation and the resurrection with the Sadducees. He quickly told them that you don't know the scriptures. Boom, 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 done. Here, this thing is taking a little time to unfold. There's an object lesson being taught. When Jesus healed a man by the pool of Bethesda, what did he tell him to do? What did he tell him to do? Mrs. White says Jesus knew that man was going to walk right into who? Doing what? Breaking their doctrines. He wanted that to happen. When they were walking through the field, picking and eating grain, he knew that it was going to create a conflict. But it's the great controversy raging. You see, we don't see it that way. It's raging today in the church right now. And God wants us to be an example of what his commandments and his doctrine are. Rita?
It's preaching the gospel for a witness.
That's exactly what he was doing.
He practiced what he knew. He witnessed by his life.
Right. I'm not talking about starting arguments and fights with people. Why did Jesus say to the rich young ruler who was part of the political and religious ruling body in front of everybody, why did he bring it to the level he brought it? Yeah, you've done all these things. That's well and fine, but there's still one thing you're lacking. That cut deep and hard. And unfortunately, the scripture says the man went away sad. That's not a good ending. What about Zacchaeus? Where did that take place? In a closet? Another tax collector. Up in a tree in a crowd. Yeah, I'll go to your house and eat with you. Another situation like Matthew, wasn't it? This one was more public even so. The murmuring and complaining that went on then. But what did Zacchaeus end up doing? I'm sure Matthew and his friends did the exact same. They repaid everything that they took. They became faithful followers. They didn't go away sad because they were sincere people looking for the truth. Yeah, Rita?
With the rich young ruler, it wasn't so much that Jesus wanted him just to give up his belongings.
Nope.
He wanted to give up himself, and he couldn't do that because that was all bound up with his possessions and his riches.
Exactly. But let's make a comparison. See, the rich young ruler was connected to what? The Sanhedrin. He had their blessing. Oh, you're going to heaven. But Zacchaeus was what by the Sanhedrin? Matthew, his friend, condemned. You're going to hell. You see the difference? Do you see how dangerous that is? Do you see why Jesus had to bring these things to the surface?
But Zacchaeus also had to give up self because yep. all the things that he was doing, that was what he lived for. And when he said he was going to pay back double for everybody that he stole from, it was giving up himself.
But you see the difference. Zacchaeus did not have the sanction of the religious leaders. See, the rich young ruler was told, you don't have to give these things up. Saul, when he was Paul, was told, oh, you're fine. You're wonderful. Now go kill everybody. We're giving you the authority. But then Saul realized he didn't have the authority of heaven. See, this is what we have to tell our friends that are living by the doctrines of men. You're not fine. The law has been taken away. And man's law. Yes, Dennis?
Paul, as in the case with the rich young ruler, Christ knew that he wouldn't do what he asked. But it was a lesson to everybody that was standing around.
Yes.
He wanted everybody to know.
Exactly.
What
Jesus felt bad about it.
Right.
He knew what his answer. You're right. By the same token, Dennis, he knew what Judas was going to do. But he tried everything he could to melt Judas's heart. The thing is, folks, Jesus is bringing these things to happen, to light, to conflict within the church to show the people you are not safe. He said these very things in Matthew that Matthew recorded, and not just him. You're teaching for commandments. The doctrines of men, you're condemned to hell. You're following men. There's no safety there. Reginald.
Yes, it's a good contrast you brought there from the rich wrong young ruler in comparison to Zacchaeus, because the rich young ruler was being commended by his associates of most probably of how good a businessman he was, you know, that he multiplied the riches, etc. But he wasn't really complying with the commandments of God. Because what Zacchaeus did is basically Zacchaeus, in the book, The Cross and the Shadow, Stephen Haskell talked about this, and he talks about the trespass offering, that you have to give back what you robbed, and you have to add onto it. So basically Zacchaeus really did comply with that particular offering by not giving only what he took, but by multiplying it and giving back. So he was really complying with the commandments of God.
Yes, he
in contrast with the rich young ruler.
And there's another good point to be taken from that. It's amazing. I don't know how old Zacchaeus was. I don't know how long he worked for the king or the Roman government or Pilate. How did he know who he robbed? How did he know all those people who he robbed and who to pay back? See, when the law of God enters in, the Holy Spirit takes control. There are no mistakes. While we're working for the devil, there's a blur. The conscience is seared. Zacchaeus knew who to go and because Jesus changed him. The Holy Spirit worked on him and he said, I got to pay this, 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 and this. He knew. The rich young ruler had no idea. Think about it. He was being sanctioned by the church. Like Reginald said, oh, you're a good businessman. It's just good business. You're a good church member. You're an upstanding citizen. Jesus was not an upstanding citizen, was he? Matthew was not an upstanding citizen, was he? Zacchaeus was not held in good rapport with the Romans, or because the Romans didn't like their tax collectors either. Why? Why didn't they like them? Were they giving Rome all the taxes they were collecting? Yes, they did, and they knew it. You see the problem? So the Romans really didn't like dealing with them, especially if they were from their own country. But they were not upstanding good citizens because they knew the whole system was garbage and they were going to get their own.
And another thing, too, is that they just couldn't go out and get tax collectors. They were a special breed of people. Because nobody wanted that job.
No, they did not. And that's another reason why they took what they thought they were worth. You see? But evidently, they were good record keepers. They had to be. Think about it. Because they had to cover their tracks. You see? Because if you remember, with the unfaithful steward, what was the first thing he did when he found out he was getting fired? He got his books in order. You see, so he knew who and what to take care of, so he had a nice place to go to. Interesting. Anyhow, I want to move on. Satan has wrought with deceiving power. This is Mrs. White's commentary in the verses we just read. Bringing in a multiplicity of error that obscures truth. Error cannot stand alone and would soon become extinct if it did not fasten itself like a parasite upon the tree of truth. Error draws its life from the truth of God. The traditions of men, like floating germs, attach themselves to the truth of God, and men regard them as a part of the truth. This is what's going on today. This is what's going on today. Through false doctrine, Satan gains a foothold and captivates the minds of men, causing them to hold theories that have no foundation in truth. And before you know it, there's no discernment between truth and error. Oh, I'm fine. Everything's good. The church says so. Now, is it true or not? Men boldly teach false doctrines. Men boldly teach for doctrines the commandments of men, and as traditions pass on from age to age, they acquire a power over the human mind. But age does not make error truth, neither does its burdensome weight cause the plant of truth to become a parasite. The tree of truth bears its own genuine fruit. Now, folks, this is why Jesus said, by their fruit you shall know who they are. He didn't pick that statement randomly. Many trees, you don't know what they are until they bear fruit. That's why it's important to know if it's the proper tree or not that you're planting. The parasites of error also bears its own fruit and makes manifest that its character is diverse from the plant of heavenly origin. We have to make sure that we are grafted into whose vine? See, the Pharisees grafted or were trying to graft into Christ's vine their doctrines. Has that happened today? We're told today that we have to accept and love everybody, right? Is that biblical? Do we have to accept? Did Jesus accept everybody's theology? Did he embrace and love everybody's theology? Is that what he did? He was having a major conflict with his own church because of their doctrines. No, we have to plant the proper tree. Well, Fernando, I'm going to tell you something right now. Unless we're walking with Christ and driven by the Holy Spirit, we don't know how to do that. You need a microphone. You see, this doctrine of love, love, love is a very dangerous doctrine when it's not planted in truth.
There's one difference between loving and like. Jesus didn't ask us to like people. He asked us to love them. Love, we love them with our actions, you know. But there's a big difference between accepting what they do and between loving them. You can still love them and not accept what they do, you know. Hate their actions, not them. So I think there's a difference.
Well, let me ask you a question. Now that you said that, because you love them, does that mean that you associate and patronize with them? See, that's what I'm getting at. You're right, Fernando, you're right. Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit love the devil. You see, and you're right. But my point is, until we become fully vested in God, we don't understand how to do that. It's hard to do. You know, David knew how to do that. How do you know that? See, love and respect are the same word, too. How do we know that David knew how to do that? By their fruit, you shall know who they are. Angela, you want to say something?
Because of Saul.
Because of Saul.
Even no matter how bad Saul treated him and tried to murder him, he still showed respect and love for him, and even when he died, he showed respect knowing that he was the anointed of the Lord.
He ripped his clothes and wept when he heard Saul was dead. And when the messenger that came and said, "Oh, I killed him," what did David do to him? How dare you lift your hand against the anointed? That is, I think, what Fernando was talking about. This is one of the reasons David was a man after God's... He loved his enemies. What about Mephibosheth? What about him? He was afraid. And he said, "You will always have a place at my table." And by the customs of the day, he should have killed him. David was upset when he found out all Saul's family was killed. Remember, Rita?
Well, we have to understand what love is. Love is not a mushy emotion. Not charity is not a mushy emotion. It's an action. It's something that you do for somebody, a benevolent action. You don't just have these mushy feeling emotions. That's not what God wants us to do.
Exactly. Do you think that the Pharisees loved Matthew?
Oh, no.
Interesting.
And also, love does not mean allowance.
Yes.
A lot of times, you know, I've heard people say, you know, they equate love with... it's okay. Everything is okay. God loves us, and He chastises those that He loves. If we love our children and they want things that are bad for them, as a parent, that doesn't mean we love them because we give them everything that they may want. Love extends to, it doesn't do away with reason.
Right.
And ability.
Exactly correct. But you see, the doctrine of the Pharisees, you hate your enemy. You destroy your enemy. Jesus said, "You're a liar. You're liars and murderers, just like your father, the devil." What did he say he was? You see? So I'm glad Fernando brought that up. Here's a great contrast again between doctrines. Jesus was visiting the hated, the downcast, the excommunicated, the enemies. He said, "You're to love the Romans." Did the Jews want to hear that? See, now today we swung back the other way and say, "Oh, we're doing what Jesus said. We're loving everybody." See how the devil works? One side or the other. You need the microphone.
I think the greatest act of love is to try to pass on the gospel to a fellow human being, because you're trying to extend Christ's plan of salvation for their life.
Amen. Fernando, you want to say something? Well, while he's doing that, go to Matthew 5.
What I was trying to say is, when you think that to love someone, you have to accept whatever they think, whatever they teach, contrary to the scriptures, then you're missing the point.
Exactly.
You don't understand. But loving, despite what they believe, meaning, you know, you don't have to accept, but despite what they believe, you still do good to them. You still, you see what I mean? You don't hate them because of what they believe, no matter, even if it's contrary to scripture. You teach what's right, but you still accept and do good to them. That's how Jesus did. That's how I understand it.
Well, you see, that brand of love is your concern for their salvation. And that only comes from one place. Matthew 5:13. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt be lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is therefore good for nothing but to be cast out and be trodden underfoot. You are the light of the world. The city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. I want to read what Mrs. White has to say about this. See, the church of the first century was very, very exclusive. We've put our light out. See, we're no longer a city on a hill. A lit city on a hill. See, back in that day, when you were traveling, it was very important at night to get into one of the gated cities. Why? Protection, especially if you were alone. And if you saw a lit city on a hill, guess what you were doing? Why would the city be lit? You're not going to see it during the day. It's a beacon. Come here. You'll be safe. Jesus said that men need to come out of the darkness into the light. This is why he used this example. Christ, in his teachings, Christ likened his disciples to objects most familiar to them. He compared them to salt and light. You are the salt of the earth, he said. You are the light of the world. These words were spoken to a few poor, humble fishermen. Priests and rabbis were in the congregation of hearers, but these were not the ones addressed. With all their learning and with all their supposed instruction in the mysteries of the law, with all their claims of knowing God, they revealed that they did not know him. How did they reveal that, folks? You see what she wrote here? You see what Mrs. White? They revealed. She didn't say, she didn't leave the they out. It was revealed that they didn't. How did they reveal that? Now think of the situation with Matthew. Were they revealing that they were not the keepers of God's way at Matthew's house? Yes. By their fruit you shall know who they are. They revealed it themselves. In the church today, are the leaders of the church revealing that they are not doing God's will? Is it evident? Where's the church going? But do we make excuses for them? Do we not hold them up to the statements that they make anymore? When a man can stand up and say, oh, we're not going to do this, this is wrong, but a few years earlier, he voted to institute it in the church? Now, which statement are you going to go with? The practice that he's denouncing, so-called doing lip service to, Jesus said, with your lips, you do me service, is the very practice he voted to institute as doctrine. Now, did he come out and say, I'm going to undo what I did, I was wrong? Is that what he said? No. He's doing lip service. What did Jesus say men were doing? And then teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. We have to apply these principles today. You're going to find that out here in the independents too. They're out there teaching all kinds of garbage. And then Ellen White says, and then they'll turn around and say, well, you can't take her statements that denounce what I just said because that's been changed. What kind of double talk is that? And people who tell me, oh, you can't go by that, Ellen White, well, you've got a computer, right? Go back to her original writings. They won't do that. They won't do that. But yet, they'll use that computer to prove their point. Are we stupid? She says here, revealed that they knew him not. To these leading men had been committed the oracles of God, but Christ declared them to be unsafe teachers. He said to them, you teach for doctrine the commandments of men, you do err, not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. Turning from these men to the humble fishermen, he said, you are the salt of the earth. Now, I've got news for you. These people that he said were unsafe and unfit did a whole lot more studying than they do today. Then, they spent their entire lives reading and studying and reading and studying. They had lawyers. They had people to decipher the old languages, and then they sat there and studied and studied. They studied 30, 40, 50, 60 years. And what does it say here? What did Jesus call them? You do err, not knowing the scriptures. What were they studying? What were they studying? Arrogance? Their own philosophies? Their own theologies? Has the same thing happened today? Has the same thing happened today? I want to read out of Patriarchs and Prophets. I think I brought the right book. Yeah, I did. Page 133. Now here, I think, is really what needs to be. Although Lot owned his prosperity, this is about Abraham and Canaan. Although Lot owed his prosperity to his connection with Abraham, he manifested no gratitude to his benefactor. Courtesy would have dictated that he yield the choice to Abraham. But instead, this is when they were splitting and they had to choose, and Abraham gave Lot the choice. You all know the story. But Lot should have turned around and said, well, no, you make the choice. I'll take what you don't want. But courtesy would have dictated that he yield the choice to Abraham. But instead of this, he selfishly endeavored to grasp all its advantages. Therein lies the problem. God has given the church the choice. What ground do you want? What should the church have said? You tell us where you want us. But instead, the church has said, we're going for the gusto. We're going to become an earthly power, accepted by everybody, rich and wealthy. He lifted up his eyes and beheld the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as thou comest unto Zoar. Now, folks, the fact that they have set up pension funds, health care systems, all this insurance and everything, who are the people that work for the church depending on? In the first century, who were the people that worked for the church depending on? Jesus or their system? Who was the church in bed with in the first century? Rome. Who is the church in bed with now? Rome. Where should we be? You really think that God is going to bring the 144,000 into this mess? They were, what? Virgins. They never got in bed with anybody but the true doctor. The most fertile region in all of Palestine was the Jordan Valley, reminding the beholders of the lost paradise. It must have been incredibly beautiful. And equaling the beauty and productiveness of the Nile and rich plains, they had so lately left. There were cities also, wealthy and beautiful, inviting to profitable traffic in their crowded marts. Dazzled with visions of worldly gain, Lot overlooked the moral and spiritual evils that would be encountered there. Why do we have churches in places like this? Why do we bring people into places like this on the Sabbath? Is it correct? Not to mention the cost of building in places like this. Why do you suppose the greatest institutions we have were built on top of land that was deemed garbage? Why? Because it was very inexpensive. It wasn't desirable. There weren't a lot of commercial development around it. The same reason Jesus walked out of the cities to give his sermons. The same reason. The inhabitants of the plain were sinners before the Lord exceedingly. But of this he was ignorant, or knowing, gave it but little weight. He chose him all the plains of Jordan and pitched his tent toward Sodom. How little did he foresee the terrible results of that selfish choice? Is the church looking to the future and the terrible results that are going to come from the choice they made? Lot lost his entire family, except for two daughters. Which, those two daughters started, what did they start? Sacrificing babies to demon deities. Did you know that? Cutting the bellies of pregnant women open, taking the child out, and sacrificing it to demons. That came from one of Lot's daughters. Where did they learn that? And their Seventh-day Adventist church in the middle of Sodom? You think? Probably so. I know that's a hard statement. But they were Seventh-day Adventists. Where did they learn that? How could they become that calloused, or that duped, or deceived? Selfish choice. This goes on in households, where one lords over the other. They don't see the terrible events that are coming. God wants a relationship, not a forced obedience. It never, ever, ever, ever works in the end. Never. After the separation from Lot, Abraham again received from the Lord a promise of the whole country. Soon after this, he removed to Hebron, pitching his tent under the oaks of Mamre, and erecting besides it an altar to the Lord. In the free air of those upland plains, with their olive groves and vineyards, their fields of waving grain, and their wide pasture grounds, of the encircling hills, he dwelt, well content with his simple patriarchal life and leaving to Lot the perilous luxury of the Vale of Sodom. Now, who was the light on the hill, folks? Which one of these two was the light on the hill? Lot got lost in Sodom and Gomorrah. Literally, he got lost. Spiritually, physically, his whole family ended up dying there. Come under the judgment of God, which means what? That judgment that rained down over there means what? Where will those people be the next time around? In the lake of fire. Abraham was honored by the surrounding nations as a mighty prince and a wise and able chief. He did not shut away his influence from his neighbors. Did Abraham become like the nations around him? No. Now, part of the promise to Abraham was what? He would become a great nation. The father of a great nation. Is this an example as to what we should be in the world today if we're to be his children? He did not shut away his influence from his neighbors. His life and character, in their marked contrast with those of the worshippers of idols, exerted a telling influence in favor for the true faith. His allegiance to God was unwavering. while his ability and benevolence inspired confidence and friendship, and his unaffected greatness commanded respect and honor. His religion was not held as a precious treasure to be jealously guarded and enjoyed soberly by the possessor, solely by the possessors. Is that what was going on in the first century?
This is exactly what Enoch was to the people. He loved them, but he couldn't have anything to do with them. He went down to the cities to tell them about Christ, but then he had to come back again because he couldn't stand associate with those people.
That's right.
That's what Abraham did. That's what we're supposed to do.
That's right. But we have become part of Sodom and Gomorrah. We are living amongst it, and then we try to get legalistic to overcome it. Whose rules are they? Whose rules are they? They're the doctrines of men being taught for the commandments of God. You see, when you can't live up to the standard, then the lip service starts. Paul found that out, didn't he? Then rigidness sets in. Trying to be legal to make yourself feel good and, I'm doing right. Really? Are you? Because you realize by those standards, David would have been condemned. You realize that? By those standards, who else was condemned to death? Jesus Christ. So be careful where you go with that. True religion cannot be held for such a spirit is contrary to the principles of the gospel. While Christ is dwelling in the heart, it is impossible to conceal the light of his presence or for the light to grow dim. On the contrary, it will grow brighter and brighter as day by day the mists of selfishness and sin that envelop the soul are dispelled by the bright beams of the Sun of Righteousness. The bright beams of the Sun of Righteousness. And when that's not happening, then people start to make rules. Now do you see why having a rule book in the Seventh-day Adventist Church is deadly? Who had rules? Pharisees. They had over 400 different do's and don'ts on the Sabbath. Can't do this. And are they dead? Did those rules die? I hear them today. Oh, you're breaking the Sabbath. Really? You shouldn't do this and you shouldn't do that on the Sabbath. Really? Where'd you get that from? Well, the rule book. What rule book? See the problem? Whose rules do they become? Teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. Doing lip service by going to church on the Sabbath. But then do we conduct ourselves on the Sabbath the way Jesus did for the rest of the day? Let's go to John 2:1. This is a very interesting situation, and we all know it very well. Most people, it's just a story. I don't know why you could read anything in the Bible and just see it as a story and not apply it. And people, oh, this is an amazing story. Jesus' first miracle. Let's read it. John 2:1. And the third day there was a marriage in Canaan of Galilee. And the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said unto him, they don't have any wine. Jesus said unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? My hour is not yet come. What was Jesus saying to her? He was not being disrespectful in his day, and you've all heard this. This is the proper and correct way to address her. But would you not know that I would be about my Father's business? Isn't that what he's telling her? But he respects what she asked. Now, Jesus knew that this was going to happen. I find it interesting that him and his disciples were invited to this wedding. Not just him, but his disciples. These were not just common people having a wedding, by the way. This was an influential crowd. Verse 5. His mother said unto the servants, whatsoever he says, do it. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone after the manner of purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece, which is 9 gallons approximately. Jesus said unto them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, draw now and bring to the governor of the feast. And they did it. And when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine and knew not where it came from, but the servants which drew it knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom and said unto him, every man at the beginning puts the best wine they have. And when men have drunk well, then he brings out the worst wine. But you have kept the good wine until now. This is the beginning of the miracles of Jesus. Now, let's take a look at what took place here. You've got a wedding. You've got Jesus. You've got water. You've got vessels. You've got wine. Folks, what is going on here? Why was Jesus there? The church, which is represented where here? Where in the story is the church represented? The bride. Now there's a governor over the church, correct? Is it Jesus? No. What, folks, the wine they were drinking, what does it represent in Scripture? The doctrine that they're being given is supposed to be the best. Do you know why Jesus went there? Do you know why he did this miracle? But there is one faithful there. They run out of their doctrine before they get to the end of time. It's not working. Son, save us. Is that what Mary said? What did Jesus say? He honored his mother's request. It was his father's business to be there. He made it clear. Jesus said, okay, bring. Now let's take that word pots and say vessels. Bring them here. She said, whatever he says, do it. She knew, didn't she? A very wise woman, wasn't she? There's a faithful one in that church that's pointing the church to who? To Jesus. Do we have a faithful witness today pointing us to Christ? Should we listen to her? What are we doing with her, though? The vessels, who do you suppose these empty water pots might represent? And it says cleansed after what? They were purified, cleansed. Fill them with water. What does the water represent in Scripture? Jesus said to the woman at the well, if you drink of the water I give you, you will never... It's a symbol of the Holy Spirit flowing from the throne of God. Fill it with water. They were cleansed, purified. You've had your doctrine in there now. Let's clean it out. According to the way I told you to do it, because Matthew specifies they were cleansed. Then Jesus said, fill them with water. Once the Holy Spirit comes in, then what do you get? The pure doctrine of whom? Then they brought it to the church. And what did the church say? Wow! Where did this come from? Where did it come from, folks? Was it the doctrine of men that they were now drinking for commandments, or it was pure right from the throne of God? Brought by whom? Brought into the vessel by the Holy Spirit that were purified. Did they want for any wine after that? Do you see why Jesus went? I suspect that through this story, I'm to cleanse this vessel according to the way that Jesus said to do, to be filled ultimately with his doctrine. Now, I find it interesting, too, where to be a light on a hill. Once they tasted the wine, what was the first thing they did? Wow! They had to tell somebody about it. The other wine was no big deal. We're not going to tell anyone. We're just going to sit here and play. But once Jesus entered in, once he straightened the church out, the woman pointed him, pointed the group to him secretly, you see, because remember it says, who was the only ones who knew who did this? There's the servants, and they're like, holy mackerel. Why do you suppose the captain of the feast wasn't involved in this? What do you suppose he would have said? Nah, that's not going to work. Don't listen to him. He would have told those servants, go buy some. You see the difference? Remember, we read the story of a light on a hill and the salt, and did the learned people get what Jesus meant? Who got it? The servants. Same thing here. Mary didn't go to her, and if you read the story, you'll see these were influential people, wealthy, there were people with some money there. Mary didn't go to the captain of the feast of the man and say, well, my son will fix it. What would he have said? Yeah, right. Did he bring any wine with him? I don't see it. No. To the lowest in the house. That's who accepted it. That's who did exactly what they were told. And that's who bore the witness. We have to stop. The next week, I'm going to continue from there on. We're going to go to Romans 7. But when Jesus is doctrine, when the doctrine of heaven is given, and people receive it with the Holy Spirit, once they've been cleansed of this mess, and folks, you can't go into the church and get cleansed anymore, just like the first century. They have to say, that is the best I've ever heard. And they're going to talk about it. See, eventually they found out what happened. Do you think everybody believed that story that was there? I guarantee you they didn't. I guarantee it was only the simple people that believed it and went and told it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before your mighty, mighty throne. We praise you, Lord, for the simplicity, again, of your word and the actions of your son. Every little thing that he did has great significance to us, Father. Help us to seek these things out and to study them so we can become a light on a hill, Father. Get this work done and go home. We praise you and thank you for the Sabbath day. In Jesus' name, amen.